universal image, a symbol of uniquely profound and powerful meaning. Standing at the edge of a new continent, the Statue of Liberty has always embodied the best of America. Its protection and its illumination. And above all, its freedom, its vast possibilities. She is our most forceful image of a rival and hope. Her right arm, torch in hand, forever upraised in a gesture of welcome. Never has hospitality been more profoundly expressed. The poet Emma Lazarus called the statue the new Colossus, the mother of exiles. The French sculptor who made it, Frédéric Auguste Bartholdi, gave his work the formal title, The Statue of Liberty Enlightening the World. The project began at a dark time, just after the assassination of Abraham Lincoln. The French people felt that the world had lost a symbol of freedom. A group of them, led by the historian Edouard de Lavallée, wanted to create an imposing memorial that would embody the French and American ideal of liberty. Bartholdi undertook the commission. It took 20 years and it cost $400,000. Most of the money came from ordinary French people. By 1876, Bartholdi had completed the right arm and torch of the statue and sent it to Philadelphia to be part of the American Centennial Exhibition. On July 4, 1884, the completed statue was unveiled and presented to the American ambassador in Paris, where it remained for a year. On the other side of the Atlantic, Americans began raising the $250,000 they would need to build the pedestal to liberty in New York Harbor. The American Committee for the Pedestal held fundraising dinners and social and sporting events, but they were unable to raise all the funds that were necessary. It was then that Joseph Pulitzer, owner and publisher of the New York World, took up the cause. He made the fundraising drive a popular crusade. American schoolchildren sent in thousands of dollars in pennies, nickels, and dimes, so that finally the pedestal could be completed. On June 17, 1885, the French vessel Iger arrived in New York Harbor with Miss Liberty in its hold, broken down into 214 separate packing cases. On the immense pedestal on Bedloe's Island were crews who were themselves mostly European immigrants, put her together again. The great French engineer Gustave Eiffel designed and built the huge iron interior framework of the statue. Over that frame, the workmen pressed molded copper sheets, 300 of them, all an incredible 3/32 of an inch thin. On October 28, 1886, she was formally installed and dedicated. President Grover Cleveland accepted the statue on behalf of the United States, declaring, "We will not forget that liberty has here made her home, nor shall her chosen altar be neglected." The statue presided over a powerful human drama that recreated America. Liberty became midwife to millions of new lives. Under Liberty's gaze, the immigrants came to Ellis Island. Ellis Island seemed the corollary of the statue, the workshop of the symbol. The great immigrant station opened on January 1st, 1892. Ellis Island became the Plymouth Rock of full-grown American democracy. The Mayflower that landed here sailed from every port in Europe. Bremen, Antwerp, Rotterdam, The Hague, Liverpool, Copenhagen, Constantinople, Piraeus, Fiume. Their cargo was a new America. The immigrants, one writer said, were common people who had made an uncommon decision. In vast numbers, they came. More than 1 million a year at the peak in 1907. It was as close as all of that diverse humanity could come to being reborn. On Ellis Island, America was reborn. The immigrants spent hours and days, and sometimes even weeks of painful uncertainty. A few were rejected, sent back. But the vast majority went on to become Americans, sustained by the idea that had greeted them, the immense, nourishing idea of liberty. America needed fresh muscle. New industries and mines needed workers, cheap, hardworking labor. Italians and Jews stitched in the sweatshops of the Lower East Side. Poles and Welshmen mined coal in Pennsylvania. Swedes and Germans and Irishmen laid the rails west across the prairie. Ditch diggers, clod carriers, stone cutters, they labored. They were to transform America from an agricultural nation to a world industrial power. And over the next 85 years, liberty kept her watch. Eventually, the great tide was seeded. In 1954, Ellis Island was closed, having received more than 17 million newcomers, forebearers of almost half of all Americans living today. Now, Ellis Island is a hollow ruin. Vandals have stripped the chandeliers and plumbing fixtures. Passageways are overgrown with vegetation. The Statue of Liberty has felt the ravages of weather and pollution for almost a century. Poles have appeared in her copper sheathing. The iron structure around which she was built has become dangerously corroded. Pieces of iron from the torch have actually been found washed up on the New Jersey shore. Unless extensive repairs are made soon, the statue will be closed at the time of her centennial in 1986, the time when she should be celebrated. On May 18, 1982, President Reagan announced the formation of the Statue of Liberty Ellis Island Centennial Commission, made up entirely of private citizens. Its chairman is Lee Iacocca, whose own parents entered America through Ellis Island. The task of the commission and its affiliate, the Statue of Liberty Ellis Island Foundation, is to plan and finance the restoration of these symbolic and historic American places. To succeed, they will have to tap the same resources of faith, imagination and dedication that lit the lamp of liberty on America's shores 100 years ago. The Liberty Centennial is for all Americans. From the grassroots launch ceremony in July 1984, right up through 1986, the campaign is highlighted by celebrations and unequaled media events. During the summer of 1985, an international festival salutes our rich and diverse cultural heritage. 1986. The centennial year of the Statue of Liberty is celebrated by all 50 states. A gala of top star entertainment, the biggest ever assembly of tall ships, and the world's largest fireworks display. The finale comes on October 28, 1986, when the President of the United States will rededicate the Statue of Liberty. In the spirit of this campaign, all Americans, individuals and corporate citizens alike, are joining to preserve these great symbols of freedom and hope. The United States Tobacco Company is committing its support to the Liberty Centennial Campaign as a founding sponsor. In fact, U.S. Tobacco's pledge of $10 million is the largest of all founding sponsors. During the campaign, through the advertising and marketing of its smokeless tobacco products and its premium wines, U.S. Tobacco is helping to bring the meaning of the Liberty Centennial into the hearts and minds of Americans through special promotions, sponsorship of the Charlie Daniels Band, racing and rodeo events. Millions of people have the opportunity to share in preserving and celebrating these unique and historic places. The Statue of Liberty has no peer as a symbol of the American dream. Ellis Island is a timeless reminder of the human courage and energy that turn dreams into reality. These are powerful presences out of our common past, impossible to forget, but all too easily taken for granted. The result of years of inattention is sadly apparent. But this evidence of physical neglect is not a sign of spiritual indifference. In restoring and celebrating these historic places, a new generation of Americans has a chance to reaffirm the vision that brought our forebears to these shores and to rekindle the beacon of hope that points the way to still brighter tomorrow.